4 weeks into their grand tour of Britain's industrial past, Fred Dibner and his steersman Alf Molyneux are making good progress. They've been running a full head of steam from the Scottish borders to the northeast of England.
I'm on my way to Sunderland to look at a great pumping station that was built to cater for the ever-increasing demand for more water. With the invention of the steam engine, far more water was needed than ever before to run the engines and equip Britain's new industries. This is Rye Oak Pumping Station, built by the Sunderland and South Shields Water Company in 1868. The station ceased operating in 1967 after a century of pumping water.
Oh, Fred, you found us. Well done.
And it contains two of the finest beam engines in all of Great Britain, which are maintained in running order by a dedicated bunch of volunteers.
These great rocking beams are like a huge version of a simple garden pump. The beams transmit steam power via long connecting rods to pumps located at the bottom of a 250-foot deep shaft. Three Lancashire boilers make steam to drive the engines.
What do you think of these? Can you go on?
Them are one heckish long connecting rods, aren't they? Compared with a lot of water pumping engines.
Yeah. Imagine the manpower and the toil that went into making these.
Yeah.
Even digging the shaft, 250 feet.
Yeah.
1860s.
Yeah.
All done by hand.
Yeah, yeah. That's a poor old crankshaft, it is. Isn't it?
Let's have a look at this maker's plate.
Hey.
There we are. Yeah. Hawthorns.
Yeah.
1868.
Brass plates are working well, isn't it? They made boat engines and all.
They did. They made trains, boat engines, ships as well. Would you like to try starting one of these engines?
There's all them levers.
Well, come on, try it.
We'll have a go. I know it's like a bit of a knack, isn't it?
You have to step up. We've got a step, seems are short. You're going to need the top step as well.
Yeah.
We're going to put quite a few turns on the steam valve. Yeah. So if you can open that, I'll tell you when to stop. Okay, that's about fine.
Yeah.
And we're going to lift these two fully and just
both,
hold them open.
Both at equal.
Both at the same time, I'm afraid.
Bloody hell. Now we're up.
And now put them down, drop them down, and go onto these two, lift those two.
These two?
Yeah, quick as you can. All right.
Ah.
And put them down, shut, steam right off.
All right, how many tons does that beam weigh?
22 tons. Team of 44 horses to pull each beam all the way from the banks of the River Tyne where they were built. Imagine that. When they got to the Sunderland Bridge, the tollkeeper took one look and he went, "There's no way you're bringing that over my bridge." But they got here somehow, so they must have got across in the dead of night.
Yeah.
All right, we'll put just a little bit more steam on, Fred. Okay, that's fine. So you can see how you can control the strokes and even the direction of the beam using these valves. All right, we'll close that off now. Beautiful.
Water supply has been restored.
Large pumping stations like Ryhope were built to provide clean drinking water after the discovery that cholera outbreaks in the first half of the 19th century were caused by contaminated drinking water. The two 100 horsepower beam engines straddle three stories of the engine house. The clean water was pumped from aquifers running through limestone rocks 250 feet underground.
To a bearing no long way away, you'd use a laser beam.
Oh, yeah.
These guys had a piece of string in their eyes.
Yeah. Well, we're a bit like that.
Yeah.
Bows and arrows.
Yes. They only generate about 100 horsepower. They would pump 81.5 gallons every stroke. 10 strokes a minute, 24 hours a day.
And what did you pump in the 24-hour period?
24 hours, about a million gallons of water.
Gallons.
Wow, that lovely smell of steam, eh? Yeah.
Beaming. Where the engines got the name from, the big beams.
How did they actually get these beams into position? Because you can see they couldn't get them in.
Yeah, well, no,
through
they
the door.
They actually came up with the walls and they jacked them up with great blocks of wood.
They built it to this floor level.
Yeah.
Winched the beams in, then built this huge roof over the top of the
building. Over the top.
And the roof actually ties the building together as well. The size of the timbers we've got and the trusses in the roof.
Wouldn't they ever drop one, you know, when things went wrong? You know?
They dropped the beam.
Yeah, well, they did, you know.
Yeah, they must have.
Yeah.
See the eyelets.
Yeah.
The idea was that roof would take the weight of that beam.
Yeah.
You never tried.
No.
And I don't think I'd like to try now. You get a lovely view of the cylinder tops. Just watch your head as you look over.
Yeah.
So you don't get a clatter from the beam. But now you can see the different size and diameter of the cylinders.
Yeah. Mm.
Wonderful intricate pieces of metalwork holding all of this together.
The governor controls the engine speed and the flywheel ensures its smooth action. At the heart of any steam engine is the boiler. The three Lancashire boilers they've got here at Ryhope date back to 1908.
My granddad did this for a lot of years.
At that time, boiler making was a major industry. Now there are very few boiler makers left. But Fred has managed to track one down.
I'm on my way to a Boilermakers in Bradford. But first, I'm stopping off to have a look at a famous Teesside landmark, the Middlesbrough Transporter Bridge.
Tell you what, stood up here, you don't need to stop for a smoke, you know.
This bridge was opened in 1911 to carry pedestrians and materials across the River Tees and was hailed as one of the great engineering feats of the time. Carries 250-foot passengers and 300 vehicles every day. I wonder if they'll let me go across with my traction engine.
Fred opened the visitor centre of the Middlesbrough Transporter Bridge 4 years ago. So with a bit of luck, the bridge master will let them take the engine across.
Yeah, there it is, out past Middlesbrough's pride and joy. The biggest transporter bridge in the world. Yeah, and it was built by William Harrell in Glasgow, who actually built the fourth railway bridge. And it was supposed to be made in Scotland, transported here in big lumps, and then riveted together, The steps at them end, that end, they used to be some down this side, and you could walk across for nothing in the morning when you were on your way to work.
I heard one time as workers on the other side had cycled to the bridge, carry the bike up and across, and that way they didn't have to pay.
Yeah, I once went up there, it's bad enough on your own, my man, carrying the bike. But then there's another good story that one the great day when they had the booze up and they opened it. The Lord Mayor fell in the river, you know, you can see his hat bobbing down. It's all that, you know. Anyway, let's go and have a closer look at it.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, ready?
All right.
Break off.
I'm actually seeing a list of tariffs from about 1911, and it says a traction engine is the equivalent to 10 shillings. I'd better go and have a word with the bridge master and see if it still stands.
The men of Middlesbrough are famous for building bridges.
They've built a few up and down the world, haven't they? I think they didn't do Sydney Harbour Bridge from here.
And one or two rivets in this bridge, isn't there?
The bridge has a travelling car deck, or gondola, which traverses the River Tees. The gondola is suspended by 30 steel cables from a trolley that runs on rails 160 feet up in the air.
Over the water!
An electric winder located on the south bank pulls the trolley back and forth.
It's steady, isn't it?
No wobbling.
The bridge's unusual design lets sailing ships with tall masts freely navigate the channel.
They didn't need to bait it up for us, did they? Nice and smooth.
Mm.
One of the fur rate knots now too, isn't it?
Mm. I hope it stops when we get to the other side.
Don't drive off till the gap's closed.
No! How much is it?
Break off. Break off.
Yeah. Hey, right. Thank you for letting us cross your bridge.
No problem, no problem at all. You want to come and see the workings?
Yeah. Hey. Yeah. Right. This is the winder, is it?
This is it?
Yeah.
All original. Yeah. 1911.
Yeah.
Hasn't changed. 500 volt, DC, 30 horsepower motors.
Oh, how long does it take you to get across?
Well, it takes on average 2 minutes. you can time it if you like, yeah.
Yeah.
But, when I'm not here, you never know what they're up to. You can drive a lot faster.
Minutes up to there, so it's just a bit less than 2 minutes. Mind you, not done yet.
Well, he's driving as per instruction.
Right, the next port of call is Israel Newton's boiler works at Nidal near Bramford.
It's 80 miles to Bradford. And the weather's fine.
The backbone of my engine, of course, is the boiler, which is needed to raise the steam to make the thing go. A steam boiler is virtually a bomb. If one of these things blew up, in fact, one did in America a few months ago, and killed 5 people and injured 40, I believe. You know, you can be lighting a fire in something that's very dangerous. And end up as the man in America did, killing 5 people, himself and his own son.
Fred's getting concerned. It's still 10 miles to Bradford. Not only is there no coal in the bunker, but the water level is dangerously low.
I think we can reach.
Oh, we're all right there.
We'll reach that. They don't check these very often, I don't think. Seems a bit tight.
Plenty of pipe.
We're all right. Can't believe this, can you? Can't believe it.
It always supposed to.
Door will not open now. It's not our day.
No, it's because of the way it's hanging, the van's leaning. What do we want to worry about that for?
I won't get the screwdriver to open the grid.
Oh, there used to be a bar in the back.
I've got a bar, but it's not been
just
off for a while.
Pull down on the door. Definitely at the top.
Is this another of your burglar-proof ideas?
No, it moves about made of wood, isn't it? That, gentlemen, is not a fire hydrant. It's a stop valve. It isn't a fire hydrant.
Eh?
Not a fire hydrant.
It's not a fire hydrant?
No, it's a stop valve. You better abort this bit of this bloody film, you know.
It's not our day, is it? Not our day.
It isn't. It's,
Do you want to look and try it?
Yeah, but it isn't. It's for turning people's water off.
Yeah. Well, best leave it then.
Yeah, it's never been open for bloody years, that. Yeah.
Don't know there's any fire hydrants.
You know there's any fire hydrants? No.
The fire hydrants are generally, and as a rule, got a bloody great big letter H and painted yellow.
Right. One here, Fred.
Eh?
One here, 20 yards further on.
It's got a letter H, has it?
Yes.
Well, you can go down
all
a bit.
All right.
We don't get any knocks.
We're not getting any knocks. We're not getting any knocks.
Eh?
We won't get any knocks. Ah, it's all yours. Oh, oops.
Though you'll usually find water, eventually...
Success.
Coal can be a little more difficult to get hold of.
If you're going on a big journey, I've had friends who, before they set off, they know roughly how far they can get. So they arrange with a coal merchant to, you know, leave some at a pub or something like that, you know.
But wherever they go, somebody always seems willing to help them out.
How are you doing?
Well, we're in trouble. We need some coal.
You need some coal.
Fortunately, in Yorkshire, Fred's fans have got all the right connections.
Right, just know a coal yard down the road with a bit of coal. Oh, if you're stuck,
yeah.
I can bring some bags.
Maybe you could. A Willis Jeep. Oh,
yeah, 1942. Not is quite it? As old as your machine.
Yeah. Yeah, is he in, the big guy, you know?
They might be out haymaking today, I could probably
get... Yeah, come coal merchant.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Any particular type?
Well, the bigger the lumps, the better. Yeah.
Right, then, I'll go get some.
All right, then. Thanks very much.
Bye.
Yeah,
see
you later.
In a bit.
Yeah, that was very
the water tanks hold 60 gallons. They're going to be another 20 minutes.
The tired and the weary.
It's all going in now.
Yeah, that's all right. Precious.
We've had this helpfulness to where we've been, haven't we? Everybody's enjoyed seeing us, talking to us, helping us. You know, so. See what I mean? Thank you, dear. Thank you very much.
Is that all right for you?
That's smashing, yeah.
Shall I take it out?
Yeah. Are you frightened of...
Frightened.
Thank you. Tell him it's Guinness, he'll drink it all.
Thank you, dear. You're very kind. Superior service. How did you manage that so quick? Yeah?
Welsh steam coal, I believe.
Is it? Oh, brilliant.
Put it in the
Yeah, well,
the
hang
back,
on. I'm not supposed to stand cut, you know.
Well, I can.
Yeah, I am. Well, just tip it in the coal box.
Right, then.
I've got bladder cancer, you know.
Oh, dear. Yeah. Is that something that's...
Yeah, and they can't mend it.
They can't?
No.
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're full up.
Yeah. Well, thanks very much.
You're welcome.
Nobody's paid him yet.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, thanks.
With the coal and water supplies replenished, Fred's getting irritated by a leak that's appeared in his boiler.
These holes are only as big as flies' legs. They're not great big gaping holes. But that's a bit of a nuisance, that one, you know. It's when it's not under pressure, it doesn't. There's no there, you know, it's dry. I mean, my steamroller, there were one, it leaked for 2 years, and it were a major job to stop it, you know, and I thought that would seal up, but it never did. Well, the boiler inspector mustn't think it's going to blow up, so we'll be all right.
These leaks aren't a problem. It's just that Fred's a perfectionist. In the old days, new boilers were put out in the rain to go rusty for 12 months, which sealed them up. But Fred didn't have 12 months. Fred completely rebuilt his engine from a depressing pile of rusty old bits. The boiler was the most challenging part. Being a steeplejack, He couldn't afford the services of a professional boilermaker. He rebuilt the whole thing himself. The boiler uses much more water to climb steep hills. Great strain is placed on the engine as 12 tons of iron slowly hauls itself uphill. But the effort's worth it. Fred is going to visit one of Britain's last boilermakers.
Boilermaking are one of Britain's most important industries. They even have their own boilermakers union. And to me, it's a great privilege to go and watch, you know, they did it in the older days, being myself a bit of an amateur boilermaker.
Nobody told us you lived on top of a mountain.
It is real Newton's Boiler Works in Bradford. Boilers are still made in the traditional way, using rivets instead of welding. It's run by Mr. Gordon Newton, who is the sixth generation in a family-run business that was founded in 1803.
Hey, we'll leave it here a minute.
Fred's proud of his boiler making, and he wants to show all the best bits off.
We got the rivets from Barnsley. He was a very nice man, and you know, for the foundation ring and up the new throat plate and round the barrel.
Yeah.
But when we hydraulicked it, everything were all right. But when you think that bloody great tank of water, there's nine rivets on each side, you know.
Oh, right.
When you go over the bump, you know, and of course it's bloody leaking, you know.
Yeah.
But I'm not bloody squealing about the leaks, you know. I think eventually they'd stop.
Yeah.
Did you
replace the box only on that?
Oh, it's got a new box and a new barrel. In fact, the only original plates of the boiler are this plate, top wrapper, and the back end.
Yeah.
You have no bother with any leaks from the, you know, from the gaskets. Well, I'm telling a lie. It's just fizzing a bit onto the side. But you can see a bit of steam coming on it.
Yeah.
We came home and from somewhere at our first trip out, and it were a bloody disaster. So we got back and we had a week off, didn't we? And in the week off, I decided, like, I got up one morning at 6 o'clock, I thought, I'll get that off, all of that.
Yeah.
I had all pipes off and everything, but time elf come. And I got that off and then got going, tap, 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 you know, and all that, you see. And then, you know, they nearly all gone, but I weren't happy. And then another guy come, who's like, larger than life man, and he says, I've got the stuff, he says. It'll block a bloody bullet hole up in an engine block. Then when he's working, he's gone to sleep. Anyway, we and it was £9.99 a bottle full. And I thought, oh, it's worth a try. I didn't really want to put any more chemic in it, you know.
No,
I mean,
no.
God's natural ways, I think, are better. You know,
yes, that's
rust.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah.
Anyway, I slung them in, corked it up, and all the leaks went. But sure, after a bit, they bloody come back again. They weren't as bad, but they come back. Anyway, it's not bloody peeing out. There's not a puddle of water on. Like you see some, don't you, steam rallying. Bloody, like a sieve, you know.
Well, I saw one with the children.
Ready for 5 minutes. And Fred tells me this is what engine men do. They fall off where it looks comfortable and relax. But I'm just short of a filler.
Here at Israel Newton's Boiler Works, they manufacture and repair all kinds of locomotive and steam engine boilers. They use traditional plate bending, flanging and hot riveting techniques. Loco boiler rebuild could cost anything from £20,000 to £200,000.
Plenty of rivets.
About 9 tonne here.
Boilers contain steam at a very high pressure, which of course is very dangerous. So the boiler maker has to make sure that the riveting and the plate work is done to a very high standard, or this could lead to an explosion and create mayhem and havoc over a great area.
My father always used to say when I came into the business, he says, never give a man a job to do unless you can do it yourself.
Agreed.
And that's how, in my opinion, all businesses should be run, but it's not so anymore. But
in the modern world of accountants.
exactly, yes.
Right, take quarter of an inch off outside.
Traction engines are an expensive business. When a quote for a boiler repair comes in at upwards of £1,500, Fred was never afraid to have a go himself.
That was for doing a special throat plate for a new boiler we've got going at the moment.
People don't realise, do they, the amount of preparation you've got to bend a piece of plate to that.
What have you.
When you tell them how much it is, like, they've been...
Exactly, £1,500, somebody in Lancashire who went somewhere else.
remains of a Ford and smoke box.
That's right, yeah.
That's right. All right, mate. Come on.
The centrepiece of Gordon's workshop is a 1930s press, which makes the curved plates common in boilers of this type.
Gordon, what pressure does it press to this?
It's only about 50 tons, which is quite amazing. That's all you need when you're hot pressing.
This is my pride and joy at the moment. We were approached by the Great Western Society about 2.5 years ago with some very old drawings going back to 1904 to make a brand new vertical steam rail motor boiler. It's quite something, I think, being more certain myself. There's 415 tubes in there. Quite some heating surface.
What pressure?
160 PSI.
That's a lot of weight, isn't it?
Yeah.
People don't realise, do they, when they look at these things, that for every square inch, there's 160 pounds trying to blow it apart.
That's right.
Yeah, it looks to me like a long-term project.
But with something like this, which there isn't one like it in the world to copy to have a look at, you've got to take your time. If you have a problem,
don't make any mistakes.
No, it's got to be done right first time.
Yeah.
Have we got a good future here, Gordon, in this works?
We've enough work, which ongoing for 12 months, and the type of work we're doing, which is a mixture between locomotive work and traction engine work, there is a definite future, and with there being a lack of skills, you'll always get the work.
How are you going on about that, about getting people to come in and learn the skills?
Very difficult. You just can't get anybody to... I don't want to wear boiler suits for a start. It's not street cred. Sorry about that. that is a problem. They don't want the dirt of their hands. A trust has now been formed. Our business would transfer to this other trust, and then from then on we can get young people in and try and make boiler makers of them. Yeah. People still want traditional type of work. The trust would be the Boiler Skills and Training Trust, and then the subsidiary or the operating company would be Israel Newton 21st Century Limited.
Right.
And that's how it would go.
Yeah.
And as boiler making heads into the 21st century, Fred and Alf are heading south to visit Sheffield, the city that made the steel for an engine like this. They'll be visiting a forge where they used to make things like the axles and crankshaft for an engine like Fred's. And they'll be going to a working museum that tells the early history of steel making in Sheffield.